This is Voyager 1, a spacecraft that has been drifting through space since 1977. NASA launched it as part of the Voyager program, initially designed to explore the outer planets of our solar system. But Voyager 1, it kept going. And today, it is the furthest human-made object from Earth, currently over 15 billion miles away. Voyager 1 gave us some first up-close looks of Jupiter, Saturn, and even Saturn's largest moon, Titan. It studied their weather, magnetic fields, and rings, and sent back stunning images that changed how we understood our solar system. Voyager did an excellent job feeding us information as it journeyed through space. But in late 2023, something went wrong. NASA engineers suddenly realized that Voyager 1 may have developed a software bug, because all of a sudden, Voyager 1's normal science and engineering data transmissions suddenly started to make no sense. It became unintelligible. No one could understand what it was transmitting. And fixing this issue isn't so easy. But this is a story of how NASA engineers, using technology developed from the 70s, pulled off one of the most impressive software fixes in history. They fixed a bug on a spacecraft moving 38,000 miles per hour when it was 15 billion miles away. Thank you for today's sponsor, Brilliant. More information at the end of this video. In order to understand what went wrong with Voyager, well, we need to understand what is Voyager and how it was made. First off, Voyager isn't some sleek SpaceX modern spacecraft. Voyager 1 is old school. It was 1970s tech built to last. I would say Voyager 1 is almost like a flying science lab. The spacecraft carries 105 kilograms or 231 pounds of scientific instrumentation. And unlike modern spacecraft, it doesn't have the fancy touchscreen interface or AI-powered autopilots. It actually runs on about 69 kilobytes of memory, less computing power than a simple calculator today. Voyager 1 also isn't alone. It actually does have a twin called Voyager 2. Both were launched in 1977, about 16 days apart, and they both have slightly different missions. Voyager 1 was sent on a faster trajectory, meaning that it reached Jupiter and Saturn quite quickly, and is now the furthest human-made object from Earth, speeding into interstellar space, completely beyond our solar system. Voyager 2, on the other hand, just took a longer, slower route, but did give us a unique chance to visit all four of our gas giant planets, including Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. It is still out there, but just in a different part of space. However, we're concentrating on Voyager 1 and what keeps Voyager 1 running. Well, firstly, you see the big round dish. That's high-gain antenna. It's Voyager's only way to talk to Earth. It sends signals using just 23 watts of power. That's about the same as a fridge light bulb. Yet NASA can actually pick up these signals from billions of miles away. In terms of power supply or batteries, Voyager 1 actually doesn't use solar panels because, well, the sun is just a tiny dot from where it is now. So it's powered by radioisotope thermoelectric generators known as RTGs. They are nuclear batteries, and they basically convert the heat from the decaying plutonium to power. These batteries were in fact designed to last decades. They are slowly running out of juice. You also get the various scientific instruments that Voyager 1 carries, mainly because Voyager 1 was built to study planets, space weather, and cosmic radiation. So it does have instruments to measure magnetic fields, plasma waves, and even interstellar particles. A lot of this gear has been turned off over time to save some power, but there are still a few sensors that are being used today. Now for the good part, the computer system. Voyager 1 runs on a custom-built computer system that is split into three main parts. You get the brain, which is the computer command system, or the CCS. You get the data manager, which is the flight data subsystem. And you get the navigator, which is the attitude and the articulation control system, or the AACS. Now, your computer command system, or your CCS, well, this is essentially Voyager's brain. It handles command execution, decodes any instructions sent from Earth, and manages fault detection and correction routines. Think of it like a central coordinator, ensuring that all systems generally run smoothly. You then get the flight data system, the FDS. So this is the data manager. It's responsible for collecting all the scientific data from Voyager's instruments. It generally formats the information that it collects and then prepares it for transmission back to Earth. And in terms of storing the data, we're actually talking about tape recorders. So old school magnetic tape is how data is stored on Voyager. And lastly, you get the attitude and articulation control system. And this is Voyager's navigator. It controls the spacecraft's orientation, and it ensures that the high gain antenna is always pointed to Earth for communication. It also ensures that the scientific instruments on board are accurately aimed at their targets. So let's have a look at the actual diagram of the Voyager computer command system, because it's pretty cool to understand how a computer system for a spacecraft that's been drifting through space since 1977 works. I mean, look, we're all nerds. Let's just accept it. So this is the diagram, which is published in the journal link below. You get the power supply. The computer system obviously relies on a power supply to operate. And in the diagram, you can see two separate power supplies, one for each processor. The two separate power supplies just ensures redundancy, backup power. So if one fails, the other one can take over. You then get the processors, processor A and processor B. This acts as the brains of the operation. And these processors interpret commands from Earth and execute tasks. They also monitor the spacecraft systems to ensure that everything is working as it should be. Again, two processors are here because if one fails, the other one can take over. You also see this interrupts and level inputs. These are like alerts or notifications that are sent to the processors. They let the processors know when something needs immediate action, such as some sort of critical event or system change. You also get the output units, unit 1 and unit 2. And these units act as messengers between the processors and the spacecraft systems. They take the decisions made by the processors, aka the brains, and they send them to the right places, like controlling instruments or antenna. You also get the command buffers, or the coded command buffers. So this handles your more specific, very complicated, detailed instructions that require intricate execution. So think of it as a system's advanced set of instructions. Then the discrete command buffer manages your simpler one-off commands, like turning something on or off again. And both buffers are there to just ensure that all the commands are executed correctly, but also in the correct order. You have the telemetry, which is part of the flight data subsystem. And the telemetry just collects data from the actual spacecraft. This can include the health status, various scientific measurements, and just sends it back to Earth via radio signals. Again, you'll notice that almost every component in the system is duplicated. Two processors, two output units, two power supplies. This just ensures that the spacecraft can continue to run if something fails. So to recap, the Voyager system is essentially like a factory control center. The processors are the managers making decisions. The output units are the supervisors just ensuring that the instructions are delivered to the workers or the different subsystems. The command buffers, I would say, are like to-do lists, just organizing tasks before they're carried out. And the telemetry system is the reporting team. It sends updates about the status back to its headquarters, which is Earth. Now, let's talk about the software that's running on Voyager 1, because that's also pretty cool. So unlike modern spacecraft, which may rely on more advanced programming languages and even AI, Voyager 1 runs on software written in mainly Fortran, which is a language that probably predates most of today's programmers. So when Voyager 1 was first launched in 1977, its software was originally written in Fortran 5. And over the years, it was ported to Fortran 77. And recently, some of it has actually been ported to C, which is a bit more modern. There is also mention of assembly as well, which is another older programming language, probably the OG of programming languages. But anyway, in a nutshell, Voyager is run on older languages, which makes sense because it was launched in 1977 and it's never been back to Earth since then. The other thing to remember is that Voyager 1 is moving further and further away from Earth. So NASA has to always keep the software lightweight and efficient. The further it travels, the slower the communication becomes, meaning that every command needs to be as optimized as possible. And there's just no room for any bloated code or inefficient routines. Everything that they do has to be lean, it has to be precise, and it needs to be designed to work in a way that fits within the spacecraft's limited memory. So you can imagine trying to update software on a computer that is older than the internet, using a programming language that many modern developers haven't even touched. And that's a general challenge that NASA engineers face when maintaining systems that are on the Voyager. They can't just push a quick update because every command takes over 22 hours to reach Voyager 1 and another 22 hours back for a response. The software has to work on 69 kilobytes of memory, which is probably another challenge. And any mistakes or bugs could actually be very serious because troubleshooting will take days long. But regardless, through all of that, Voyager 1 was doing a great job. It was designed for this. It's basically a space tank. But even the most reliable spacecraft can have issues. And unfortunately, in November 2023, Voyager 1 stopped making sense when it was sending its data transmissions to Earth. In fact, the flight data system began sending indecipherable, repeating pattern of codes that NASA just couldn't understand. Voyager 1 had a bug, and NASA had to come up with a solution quickly. But how do you fix a software bug that's 15 billion miles away? So for decades, Voyager 1 has been faithfully sending data back to Earth. But in late 2023, something changed. NASA stopped receiving any meaningful communication from Voyager 1. The problem was a bug in one of the three onboard computers, specifically the flight data system. And remember, the system is responsible for collecting the scientific data from the instruments on board Voyager 1. It also gathers information about the spacecraft's health, and it packages all this information and sends it back to Earth. The interesting part is that Voyager 1 wasn't completely dead. NASA could still send commands to it, and NASA was receiving commands just fine, was just not really making sense. And the problem was that the flight data system wasn't communicating properly with another key system called the Telemetry Modulation Unit, or TMU. This system is responsible for actually transmitting the data back to Earth. And instead of sending useful scientific data back to Earth, the TMU was stuck sending repeating patterns of ones and zeros, almost like it was frozen in a single frame. In fact, if Voyager 1 was a person, this would be like NASA asking the person questions and then the person responding with the same response over and over again. So at first, NASA engineers tried what any software engineer would try first. They did a simple restart, hoping that if they reboot the flight data system, it would bring back everything to normal. But then after sending that command and waiting nearly 2 days for a response to travel from Voyager and back to Earth, the problem actually didn't go away. This meant that the bug wasn't temporary and it wasn't something simple to fix. It was something deeper inside of Voyager 1 software. And fixing it wasn't like fixing a switch. So at this stage, Voyager 1 unfortunately stopped sending back useful data to NASA, which left the NASA engineers in a bit of a pickle. But through some ingenious troubleshooting, they actually managed to bring it back online. Here's how they did it. And they described their process in a blog post on JPL, as well as a Reddit discussion. What they found was that even though Voyager 1 wasn't sending back data that they could understand, the radio signals that it transmitted were still at the right frequencies. And this told engineers a few things. One was that the radio transmitter was working. Two was that the antenna was correctly pointed to Earth. And three was that the spacecraft had power. But instead of it sending back meaningful information, they know that the signal was just sending repeating patterns of ones and zeros, almost like it was stuck. So this suggested that the part responsible for the data transmission, the flight data subsystem, wasn't actually talking properly to the telemetry modulation unit, which sends data to Earth. and that's how they were able to single out where the issue was from. So they then performed some general troubleshooting steps. First, they did some command checks. Engineers sent commands to Voyager 1 just to see if it would respond. It did, which was a good sign. They then performed some reset attempts. They did try the good old-fashioned restart method on the flight data subsystem, but again, it did not fix the glitch. The data was still nonsensical. And then lastly, they did some memory investigations. So they did suspect that the problem was with the FDS memory, so they decided to dig a bit deeper there. So they tried to send commands to write directly into the flight data subsystem's memory, aiming to try and change how it was sending the data. Because after several tries and different commands, something changed. Because Voyager 1 now started sending back a stream of raw data that made sense. At first, it didn't make sense. But with some clever decoding, the engineers actually realized that this data was a direct dump of the flight data subsystem's memory. And this was a goldmine because it then showed them exactly where the problem was. A specific memory chip in the flight data subsystem had gone bad. And this faulty chip actually stored some important code. Now, in normal circumstances, one would call the instrument back to Earth, replace the chip, and send it back on its way. But Voyager 1 was 15 billion miles away, so they couldn't do that. Engineers came up with a smart workaround. First, they relocated the code. So they moved the affected software code to other parts of the flight data subsystem's memory, other parts that were still working. But there wasn't a single empty space big enough to store all of this new code. So what they did was they divided and conquered. They split the code into smaller pieces, and each small piece spoke to one another, and then they stored each small piece in different locations. They also updated other parts of the system and told the system to point to the new location if they needed those specific pieces of code. So once it was done, they sent the first piece of relocated code to Voyager 1. Given the vast distance, it took about 22.5 hours for Voyager 1 to actually see and receive the command. And then NASA had to wait another 22.5 hours to hear back whether the command was successful or not. But by April the 20th, Voyager 1 successfully processed the new code and began sending back health and status updates, the first time in 5 months. Over the following weeks, engineers continued to remove the remaining pieces of broken code, and by June 13th, Voyager 1 was completely, fully back online, and it was transmitting both engineering and science data. Reading about how they solved this issue was just truly remarkable. The team overcame challenges like working with huge distances and a huge delay in time. The commands took nearly a day to reach the spacecraft, and then a day to actually receive a response. They were also working with old technology from the 1970s, and with Voyager's limited memory of 69 kilobytes, must have been hard to figure out how to make these updates. But they did it. And it's pretty cool to watch the spacecraft with technology developed in the 1970s making its way through space and sending us back some really useful information. And before I end off, I just want to say thanks so much for today's sponsor, Brilliant. When Brilliant first reached out to sponsor this video, I had to laugh because I've been using the app for a pretty long time. It felt ironic, almost like the universe was aligning. If you know my videos, you know that I love breaking down complicated ideas in ways that are fun and to keep things interesting. Because talking about the history of punch card programming for 20 minutes might not be everyone's cup of tea until you add some drama. But that's exactly why I like Brilliant. They do the same thing with topics like algorithms, neural networks, and even quantum computing. And yes, you're correct, algorithms can definitely be dramatic. Like, if you take their algorithm course, instead of dumping theory on you, which can get a bit boring, they guide you through puzzles, like finding the shortest path in a network. It's a lot more interactive, it's hands-on, almost like you're playing a game. So if you ever wanted to explore topics like data science, programming, or math, yeah, math is a good one. Try Brilliant. It's great. Like I said, I use it myself, and you do develop a powerful daily learning habit. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/codingwithd, or you can even click the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Thanks again, Brilliant. Thanks so much for watching. If you like my content, please like, comment, and subscribe. I will see you in the next one. Cheers.